time. He's here. Brother Tarek, is Ahmad here? Sheikh Morsy, Ahmad is so used to me pronouncing his name that way that when I did it the other way, he said, no, I want to hear Ahmad because I've been calling him that for the past 10 years. He says everybody calls him Ahmad now because I've been using it for 10 years with him. I say, Ahmad, it doesn't sound right. SubhanAllah. Okay, I'm gonna start this up. Okay, here we go. Y'all ready? Okay. In alhamdulillah, wassalat, wassalam ala wa rasulullah. We're here today, guys, to continue our talk and question and answers about exaggeration in Islam, because that's what we spoke about last week. And unfortunately, Facebook didn't miss a whole lot of your questions. So we're continuing this topic today to answer those questions. And also, just let you guys know, Dremali will be joining us. He's making salat and he had to move to a new house, but he said he might be a little late, but he'll be in here too. So the topic again today is exaggeration in the religion. How can we recognize whether or not we are exaggerating when it comes to performing our obligations? And how can we recognize if we are exaggerating when it comes to performing voluntary deeds? This is the topic. And I want to start it off with a great question here that Brother Ahmad posed to us. He says, dear Sheikh, some people have a hard time giving dawah. So they share the knowledge that they learned from Sunnah followers with their family. Whenever we try to share it with others outside of the family, people want to argue and fight with you. So what do you suggest we do? And again, he lives in Pakistan right now, in a part of the world where there's a lot of innovation. And if he sees something, we're supposed to enjoin the good and forbid the evil, and he'll tell them in a nice way that that's wrong, they want to argue and fight with him. So his question to you is, what do you suggest a person like him does?
Well, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen, wassalatu wassalamu ala sayyidil mursaleen, sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Dear brother, Allah said in the Quran, وَادْعُوا إِلَى سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنِ. Call to the way of your Lord, of your Rabb, of Allah, with hikmah, wisdom, and good advice. So what is the difference? بِالْحِكْمَةِ, it means you go very slowly with the people, especially people, they have innovations or they follow a certain madhab. Like in Pakistan, I went there, and in Bangladesh, I was working in Saudi Arabia embassy in Bangladesh, so I stopped sometimes in Pakistan. People, they follow Hanafi madhab, and these people, they are very difficult to change. They think the madhab is a religion. You know, whatever Abu Hanifa said, it is like the Prophet said. So we have to go slowly with them, with hikmah, you know, because most of them, they don't understand. And they are raised like this. So you go slowly with them, tell them if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is among us now, and he told you, do this. What do you think about that? You will tell the Prophet, no, I am following Abu Hanifa, or Abu Hanifa have to approve, oh Prophet, what you say, this is doesn't make any sense. And I told some people here from Pakistan, when I was in Centralia, Illinois, they are from Pakistan, they know Hanafi madhab and stuff. I told them, assume the Prophet is among us now, and he is telling us something to do different from your madhab. So what you will do, you will tell the Prophet, wait, we will take the opinion of Abu Hanifa. nothing. No, we cannot do that. And they are accepted, mashallah, alhamdulillah, and they have been changed. So as Imam Malik, radiallahu anhu, or rahimahullah, one of the big scholars, Imam Malik, Imam Ahl al-Madinah, one of the famous madhab al-Maliki, he said, he pointed towards his finger towards the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he said, الكل يؤخذ من كلامه ويرد عليه إلا صاحب هذا المقام. Everyone, every scholars, we take from his opinion sometimes, and we leave some of his opinions, but except this, the one who have this grave, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whatever the Prophet said, and it is authentic hadith, we have to follow. Anyone else, no matter who is have knowledge, whatever, famous, whatever, if he said different from the Prophet, we should tell them, what is the proof? What is your burhan? What is your dalil? كل يؤخذ من كلامه. So we take, we don't accept, consider anyone, no matter how much he studied, as a prophet. Prophet first, because Allah told us, follow the prophet. Okay? He told us, وَاتَّبِعُوهُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ. Follow the prophet that you will may be guided. So the hidayah is to follow the prophet. And the prophet in Surah Al-Imran himself, in the Quran, Allah said, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِ. If you love Allah as you claim, then follow me. Loving Allah, it means follow the prophet, his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So you go with them with al-hikmah. Al-hikmah first, very nice. Next step, if you spoke to them enough time with al-hikmah, with wisdom, kindly, with kindness, they did not accept, then you go to maw'idha. What is maw'idha? Advice. To warn them from the Quran and the Sunnah, that Allah can punish you if you don't follow the Prophet. Your action will not be accepted. So you go to next step, is to warn them, to make them fear the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You make them fear that the Prophet will not give them from Al-Kawthar, the river in the hereafter, one cup of the water of this well, Al-Kawthar, inna a'tainaka Al-Kawthar. And Al-Kawthar, it is a river in heaven, or it is a well that the Prophet will give all his followers one of this water, Al-Kawthar. And this Al-Kawthar, when you drink from it, the Prophet said, you will never be thirsty after that. But the Prophet, he will find the people, some people, they are online, staying online. And some, the angels, they take some of them outside the line. They tell them, you cannot drink, you know. And the Prophet, he said, Ya Rabbi Ummati, this is my Ummah, I know them, because of the wudu, atharul wudu. You know, when we make wudu, the signs of the water on our forehead, our hands, our legs, it comes very bright with nur. So some in the line, they have it. So the Prophet recognized, this is Muslims. Why do you took them? The angels, they prevented them from drinking this Al-Kawthar water from the Prophet. Then it will be said to the Prophet, إِنَّهُ إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي مَاذَا أَحْدَثُوا بَعْدَكَ. You don't know what they are created from innovation after you. Then he will say, suhqan, suhqan. It means destruction for them. So it means from this hadith appear that some Muslims, they used to pray with good intention, but they will not drink from Al-Kawthar by the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is how to call the people, make them the love the Prophet, but you tell them what is the real love, to follow him. The love, you show it through following his sunnah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Alhamdulillah. And brother, on that note, brother Ahmed has another question too, and it's wonderful how you ended that. He says, how do you show love for the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa Is it simply by following his sunnah? Is that enough? If not, what else can we do?
How what? What did the word?
How do we show our love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Is it just by following his sunnah? Is that enough, or is there something else that we need to do to show our love for him?
Yeah, to show your love, as the Quran said, follow him. Then when you follow the Prophet, this includes everything. Following the Prophet, you follow his sunnah in the prayer, you follow his sunnah in the fasting, in fasting Ramadan, in Hajj, you follow his sunnah when you speak to the people. You follow his sunnah when you treat your wife and your husband and your children. You follow his sunnah how to be truthful towards the Muslim and even non-Muslims and even towards the animals. This is his sunnah. His sunnah includes the whole life, everything.
Alhamdulillah. And also, Brother Ahmad wants to know, with what's going on in the world today, and again, he's in Pakistan, and the attacks and bad things said and made upon our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how do we defend him? Do we, you know, if we say anything, the people may harm you, but do we say it anyway? How do we defend the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he is being attacked like he is today?
You defend the Prophet through following him first, then by writing, not by harming people, by following the legal ways to protest, to boycott the products of France, to punish them. This is legal. Okay, but this is severe punishment for them. This message, if we boycott their product, France product, we will teach them to respect the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and our religion, because this is the only way they understand the economic. Okay, then we tell them we have free also to buy your product or not. Then from the same cup, from the same way thinking it's freedom, we will use our freedom also not to buy their product. Wallahu a'lam.
Okay, also, Brother Ahmed wants to know, we understand that loving Allah is compulsory and having love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is too. But how can a person such as myself balance between the two? I don't want to end up loving the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than Allah. So what suggestions do you have for us to be able to strike the balance in our love between Allah and his Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam?
Of course, we love the Prophet because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose him. Why we love the Prophet? We love the Prophet because we believe that he is a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah said, if you love Allah, follow the Prophet. So there is no contradiction. No contradiction. Loving the Prophet, it is not only emotional love. It is by your behavior. How much you follow him. Because you love him. If you love your wife, assume you will do anything your wife she wants from you, or the opposite. Okay? The love is to follow, to obey. Okay? And the loving the Prophet doesn't contradict of loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because we love the Prophet because he is a messenger of Allah. Okay? Because he is connected, because he is the best one, because Allah praised him. This is why we love him. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No contradiction.
He wants to know, though, how can you strike the balance? How can you know if you love him more than you do Allah? He said he might be afraid that he might have more love for the Prophet.
You love him, but don't commit shirk. As some people, they go extremely in love. They make shirk by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they give him names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they think that the Prophet can do anything for them now. Okay, they call him, oh Prophet, do this for us now. He cannot benefit you anything. The Prophet, he needs your dua now. Okay, so he can reach the highest degree, the wasila, which is the wasila. Okay, Allah said, وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ in Surah Al-Furqan, وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَتَهَجَّدْ بِهِ نَافِلَةً لَكَ عَسَىٰ أَن يَبْعَثَكَ رَبُّكَ مَقَامًا مَحْمُودًا. Allah told the Prophet, in the night, do midnight or after Qiyam al-Layl, maybe Allah will raise you to the best level in heaven, and this will be for one person. Then the Prophet, he told us to make dua for him to reach this level, and this level called the al-wasila. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if someone heard the adhan of the prayer, if he heard the adhan, you say like the muaddin says, like the caller says, if he says Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, you say Allahu Akbar till the end, and after that you do prayer on the Prophet, say Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad till the end, like in التشهد, and you say Allahumma rabbi hadhihi ad-da'wati at-tamma was-salati al-qa'imah ati Muhammadan al-wasila wal-fadila wab'athhu al-maqama al-mahmuda alladhi wa'adta, he will take my shafa'ah. So the Prophet will do shafa'ah, intercession for you. So after every adhan, when you repeat with the muaddin and you ask Allah to give the Prophet al-wasila, then the Prophet, the reward from the Prophet will make shafa'ah for you. Okay?
Yeah, he also says where he lives at, so many people say that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is still alive in his grave, and that he is light. He said, is this true?
Well, Allah said in the Quran, he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, this is Quran, innaka mayyitun wa innahum mayyitun. Mayyit means you are dead. Allah told the Prophet, this is Quran, you are dead and they are dead. It means your everyone will die. Okay? And he said in Surah Al-Imran, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلِ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلًا قَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ. If Muhammad died or he is killed, you will turn your back to the religion. It means everyone will die. He died, but now he is a shaheed with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He can bring him to life. That like the martyrs, when they are killed, they die, but Allah will give them the spirit, their spirit will go to heaven. Allah said that the martyrs, ash-shuhada, ahya, they are alive, but they did before, they died. Okay? So the Prophet died, but after he died, you know, he's with Allah in the heaven, inshallah, because he is better than martyrs. Allah said, وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ قُتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتًا. Don't think that those killed in the way of Allah, dead. بَلْ أَحْيَا, but they are alive. They receive provision, risk. Okay? And in the hadith, authentic hadith, that أَرْوَاحِ الشُّهَدَاء, the spirits or the souls of the martyrs will be in a birds, in a body of a bird. يَسْرَحُونَ فِي الْجَنَّةِ, they fly in al-jannah, they eat from the fruits and everything, they drink from the rivers of al-jannah till the day of judgment, because they sacrificed their life. Okay, so the Prophet, we say he is alive like martyrs, yeah, this is right. But he did not die, this is wrong, because everyone will die. Even Jibril will die. Even the angel of death will die. Everyone will die. Allah will be alone. Alone. And he will say, لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ. The kingdom belongs to whom now? No one will answer.
Subhanallah. Subhanallah.
Yeah. Then Allah will answer himself. He will say, this is Quran. لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَّارِ. It is for Allah, Al-Wahid, the one. So everyone will die. Allah said that. كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانِ. Everyone on the earth will die. Okay? So, but he is Nur, like physical Nur? No. He is spiritual Nur for us to guide us? Yes. Okay? Spiritual Nur for us. But we didn't say the Prophet is among us now, because I know some people, well, Pakistani people, they told me, doctors, they told me, people, they love the Prophet, they make a halaqah, and they say, well, the Prophet, he is coming now. They stand up. They stand up. It means they think that the Prophet is among them now, alive, now with them. This is innovation, and this is exaggeration, and this is not what the Sahaba did. The Prophet did, and when even we visit the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is adab and the manners. We say, Assalamu alayka ya Rasulallah, nashhadu innaka qad ballaghta ar-risala. We witnessed that you conveyed the message. وأديت الأمانة, and you completed the أمانة, the trust. ونصحت الأمة, you advised your أمة, your nation. فجزاك الله عنا خير الجزاء. We make dua, we ask Allah to reward you the best reward. Not more than that. Don't say the Prophet gave me, or this is shirk. So the limit, there is red line. Don't associate anyone with Allah, even the Prophet. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one time a man came to him, ما شئت ما شاء الله وشئت. He's telling the Prophet what Allah wants and what you want. He said, you made me equal to Allah. Say ما شاء الله ثم شئت. Say ما شاء الله and then what you want, not with Allah. Don't even talk. Because the Prophet is a human being still. Don't call him the same thing like call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? Wallahu a'lam.
Dr. Ibrahim Dremali has joined us. You can add to that too. I know this is a topic we like to talk about too. The question was about from our brother Ahmed. He said that a lot of the people in Pakistan say that the Prophet is still alive in his grave and that he's light and all that.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaykum assalam, Fadilat al-Sheikh. Kif al-hal?
Khair, alhamdulillah. Allah barik fik ya rab.
Alhamdulillah.
Bismillah wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah. In fact, when you started, I was in a car. I just arrived with my neighbor here to put my new house. They don't have internet. But I listened from the beginning. Wallah, brothers and sisters, the people think we are Hanafi madhab. Believe it or not, they are not Hanafi. Abu Hanifa, actually the greatest Imam. We have four Imams, but he's number one, especially the people of Ahl al-Kalam, the people who exchange the Quran, the word. But unfortunately, those people, good people by the way, excellent people, in fact. They love Rasulullah sallam, yes. They love the Quran more than anything in their life. In fact, I teach in daily basis, they concentrate and write the Quran, not even to pray right. No problem with that. The people, yes, the problem is not that. The only way to deal with this kind of people, honestly, as the Sheikh Mustafa just said, بِالَّتِي أَحْسَن جَادِلُوهُمْ. Speak with them, argue with them in a nice way. You know, we myself actually, one day I went to Khutbah al-Jum'ah and I came from the airport to the Khutbah al-Jum'ah. I don't have a hat, only a hat. And somebody gave me a hat. and he refused to listen to khutbah al-jum'ah and behind me without even covering my head. But that's ignorant. In fact, he's an old man. He are like 60 years old or more. My point here, this kind of people, in fact, Alhamdulillah. My PhD actually in fiqh al-madahib, the four madahib, I understand the mentality of those people. As Ali ibn Abu Talib, radiallahu anhu, قال, خاطب الناس على قدر عقولهم. Speak to the people according to their mentality. For example, they are extreme Hanafi. I'm actually the adults. Now the Allah, the adults, extreme Hanafi. But they're actually not Hanafi. They think they are Hanafi. They think they are Hanafi. Those people, the only way, listen to them more and know and take everything from their mind and their hearts. The most important thing, with all my respect, what I deal with them now since I came to America like 35 years, the only listen and smile and agree. And after everything speak, also choose the right word to speak to give the message. As Allah Azza wa Jalla, Sheikh Al-Mustafa, بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ بِالْحِكْمَةِ you have been wise. But look at the person first. We have to look at his eyes. Read his eyes. What exactly he wants from you. And don't argue. If you argue, you know, you lose. Allah Azza wa Jalla, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ شَرِّهِ سورة الأعراف لا ما أنساني إلا الشيطان ولا أكرم وإذا خاطبوا الجاهلون قالوا سلام. If the ignorant person يصير سلام smile.
سورة الفرقان
الفرقان 63 آية نمبر 63 you're right. My point, if you listen a little bit and listen to them more, and we speak, and you smile, and you are right, but just add something, not a lot. If you lose a lot, you lose again. If you argue, with all my respect, actually, husband and wife, if you listen, and that person will bring everything to you, that's it, has nothing else to lose. Wait a little bit. And the ayah clear. بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَايَرْ وَالْآنْ الْحَسَنَةِ that means right words. Not بِدْعَةِ حرام this, that. No, you lose it like this. And actually, now all my respect, deal with your kids and your wife and husband, the same thing. And our example, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he always listen. Allah subhanAllah. When I start one of the courses of Al-Aqidah, I went to Jordan with Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah ta'ala. And then people from Al-Ahbash, that is extreme people about the Sufis, they came with Sheikh Al-Albani to make argument with them, speak. And Sheikh, I remember I saw him actually, if I am in his place, I will just kill that person. In the spot, he started to speak too much. And the Sheikh just listen. And after they finish, Qala, Allah yarhamu, may Allah yarhamu, Qala, intahayt, did you finish? Once, and he said, none, and he start. Third time, three times. Just listen, الآن سأتكلم, now I will speak. Now I speak and you listen to me. I listen to you, listen to me. And those people, they start to argue immediately. I say, Hitta, you stop. I give you a chance to listen. And actually, I remember that there were more than 1 hour and 30 minutes. They're speaking against the Sunnah, by the way. Sufi, but the blind Sufi people, blind. Then after that, 1, 2, 3 times. I say, if you don't listen, that's it. They listen. But the point, the Sheikh was listening to them. But me, this time, I learned. But me, myself, sometimes I get angry. Especially when about fabricated hadith or something. Say, Abu Hanifa said, and he never said that. I get angry sometimes. But wallahi, I remember the Sheikh, may Allah Azzawajal rahma, I always came down the only way, listen. Give a chance to the people. Just Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hikmah, wisdom, and nice words. Wallahu subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Alhamdulillah. And again, guys, it's just a reminder of how we emphasize in our Aqidah class over and over. Don't argue. Just, you know, turn away from people who are foolish, you know. And here's a question from Sister Tony from our website. She's changing the subject to the night prayer, the witr. She said, which is better? Is it better during the last, because we talked about how Allah comes down to the lowest heaven during the last third of the night. She said, is it better to supplicate during the last third of the night? Or is it best to just do a 2 rakat prayer or something? Which is better if you want to really get reward for talking to Allah during the last third of the night? Would it be better to just make supplication, make dua? Or should she do prayers, 3 rakat prayer or something? She wants to know.
Dr. Ibrahim.
Wallahi, this is an important subject here. By the way, sister, brother and sister, Sister Tony, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Salat al-Isha, Hadith Aisha, radiallahu anha, قال, 11 rak'ah, في رمضان, وغير رمضان, 11 rak'ah, he used to do after Isha, in Ramadan, and other than Ramadan, always 11 rak'ah. But of course, it's up to you. You can pray immediately if you are tired. Me, myself, I'm delivering myself here. If I'm extremely tired, something happening here or there, I pray with it before I sleep. But most likely, I'm fresh, normal after Isha, immediately I sleep. I wake up in the morning because I'm writing a book right now. I do early, and my witr, just I make it before Fajr, half an hour, 15 minutes before Fajr. But I make the Quran, my tahajjud, you can do that. And make the dua after that in the witr. Or if you are tired, extremely tired, before that, you can be after Isha now, you will until after, by the way, tahajjud time, immediately, when you wake up before Fajr, 1 hour, 2 hours, that's Fajr, that's tahajjud. Two rak'ah, no problem with that. But don't push yourself. If you are able to do it, alhamdulillah, if you are unable to do it, you cannot, it's no problem, inshallah.
Also, guys, if I could add, remember, you know, we always like to remind you of the companions too. Remember, this came up during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was Abu Bakr and Umar. Abu Bakr and Umar got into an argument, a little slight argument about when would be the best time, you know, to perform, you know, the witr or the night prayer. And because Abu Bakr, he was a merchant and he liked to sleep during the night and get up early. So he would perform his Isha prayer and then make his witr and go to sleep. Whereas Umar was a night person. He would pray during the night. So they were arguing as to which one received the blessings, the most blessings. And that's when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, you're both right. He said, do good deeds according to your capability. He said, Abu Bakr is not able to wake up in the middle of the night. He said, but Umar, you stay up all night long and hardly get any sleep. He said, Allah likes for us to do good deeds according to our capability. He said, and something like this is not worth talking about. So I always, you know, remember sharing that with my daughter when she was younger, you know, if you can't, because she had to go to school, you know, if you can't wake up in the middle of the night, you can make your little rakats, you know, after Isha before you go to bed. So again, do the good deeds according to your capability. Inshallah.
Allah, مستطعتم. Fear Allah as much as you can. Allah say that.
Okay. Okay, here's a question from May, Sister May. I got your question, May. May wants to know, is the hadith about paradise lying under the foot of your mother, is that hadith authentic? We hear it all the time. Is it really authentic? Paradise lies under the foot of the mother. If so, can you also explain that hadith?
The meaning of alhamdulillah, yeah, this hadith is famous hadith, and al-jannah taht aqdam al-ummahat. The meaning of it also, it is correct. فَلْزَمْ قَدَمَيْهَا. It means if you stay to help, to serve your mother, to be at her foot, it means you are under her needs. If she needs anything, you answer your mother. But I don't remember how much authentic this hadith. Maybe Dr. Ibrahim, he knows.
Yeah, actually the hadith actually daif. Hadith daif. But the meaning of the hadith,
yeah,
beautiful. In fact, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, hadith, that hadith sahih, your mother, your ummak, thumma ummak, thumma ummak, thumma abu. Your mom, your mother, and then your father. And not only that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the mom is the most important thing in any human being. And actually, the moms actually love the boys even more. But my point is the hadith is da'if, but the meaning of the hadith is beautiful. Okay. And one of the sahaba, he went to make jihad with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Young jihad, and he said, "Do you have your parents alive?" Yes, and he yes. I said, "Make jihad with them," but he was the only one with the parents. He made jihad. Don't go. He's young, and he said, "Do not go with me. Make jihad with your parents." And many hadith about the mother, but the mom is, you know, my brother. My mom lived with me all my life, and all of us, we love our mom. Think, wallahi subhanahu wa ta'ala, even now, when they give all the action today, one of the sisters, she's actually a new Muslim, she become Muslimah, and now, mashallah, she memorized the Quran. And her mom, she's not Muslimah. And she called me actually last month, you know, my mom, she asked, you know, I have to take care of her, no one can take care of my mom. And she should. Her father, she is not, her father actually dead. So you should take care of your mom. And today she called me, wallahi al-azim, and she said, yeah, doctor, so my mom now, she become like 80 years old, and she cannot even recognize herself. She's insulting me, and she cursed me, and. And I told her, wait. And that's today afternoon. After that, subhanAllah, Rameen, she died, her mom. And believe it or not, the sister, she was panicked, she was dying, crying so much. And she won. She won. My mom insult me because she's Muslima. She become Muslima. But the sister, wallahi, don't forget, Allah Azza wa Jal, especially mother, their soul attached to the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All the female, of course, but especially your mom. Doesn't matter if she even she, whatever she said, but she will get angry with you, insult you even. I know it's not right, but if they do whatever she do, still she is your mom.
And we have a question here.
Okay, wait, Sister Laila, about this hadith. Al-Jannah taht aqdam al-ummahat. In this way of saying it, Dr. Ibrahim, he said this is daif, weak.
Yeah.
But there is another hadith. If we add it to this hadith, it will confirm it. إذا أضيف له. والحديث, it is in front of me. رواه ابن ماجه والنسائي والحاكم وصححه. أن رجلا إيمان قال يا رسول الله أردت أن أغزو I yeah. want to go to for battle with you. قال هل لك من أم? Do you have a mother? قال نعم. Yes, I have a mother. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, he told him, فالزمها. Stay with your mother. فإن الجنة تحت رجلها. And you know, so this is supporting the hadith. So he said, Al-Jannah, the paradise under the feet of your mother. So when we add this hadith, the da'if hadith with another, this is sahih hadith.
Yeah.
These three people, they narrated it. And even they say authentic. رواه الحاكم ابن ماجه والنسائي والحاكم وصححه. But the point here, so this is our job to, even if the mother non-Muslim, you have to serve your mother. It doesn't mean your mother necessary, if she is non-Muslim, she will not enter Jannah. No, this is something different. But your job to respect and help your mother, especially if she is Muslim. And even if she is non-Muslim, you still have to help her, respect her, support her. So the meaning of this hadith, if we add it to another hadith, يُقَوِّيهِ inshallah, make it stronger. Wallahu a'lam.
Yeah, and the sister wants to know, when we say a hadith is weak, does that mean it is not authentic or that it is partially authentic?
Okay, alhamdulillah. When we say hadith da'if, it doesn't, see, the degrees of the hadith, this is ilm hadith. The hadith can be weak for any simple reason, okay? But the hadith da'if doesn't mean it is not true. The hadith da'if can be true if it's supported, the meaning supported by another hadith, have the same meaning. So yuqawi, okay? So they strength it together. There is another hadith or two hadith, okay? So can be supported. But we say, when we say this is da'if weak, this is da'if jiddan, this is another hadith, a degree da'if jiddan. Very weak is different. Weak is different from very weak, but it is not fabricated. But what we should do with the weak hadith, this is some ulama, they say, we accept it or we do fi fada'il al-a'mal. Like if something, sunnah, whatever, the hadith talking about something not in aqidah, then we can do it. Some ulama, they say, no matter, if it is weak, we don't accept it at all. Okay? But we don't refute the weak hadith from the beginning because we have to see if the meaning of this weak hadith can find it in another authentic hadith or not. So this is, we have to go ask the scholars, the ulama, like Dr. Ibrahim, and so we know, okay? Not to refuse it like this, as weak, throw it in the garbage, no. Wallahu a'lam.
In fact, brothers and sisters, I explained the book of Ulum al-Quran, the science of the Quran, with the Huda University and with Sunnahfollowers. And actually, you go to YouTube, Ibrahim Dremali, I think also Sunnahfollowers, the science of the Quran and science of the Hadith, the book of science of Ulum al-Quran, the science of the Quran, and also another book, science of the Hadith, Ulum al-Hadith. You can go to that, inshallah, then more details. Of course, for the student of knowledge, it's for the university, if you want to in physical to do that, inshallah, to look at it, inshallah. More details, if you look at that, more details, inshallah.
Okay. Also, this is still from Sister Isra. She says, when we call another Muslim a kafir and he or she is not, we know the hadith that you are cursing yourself. But is the same appropriate or the same true when we refer to someone with bad behavior as being ignorant or foolish? Are we cursing ourselves if that person is not ignorant or foolish, even though they're behaving that way?
So the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إذا قال المسلم لأخيه, if the Muslim said to his brother, يا كافر, O kafir, The Prophet said, فَقَدْ بَاءَ بِهِ أَوْ بِهَا أَحَدُهُمَا. One of them will be kafir. If he is not kafir, it means you will be kafir. Because if he is Muslim and you say the Muslim, he is kafir, it means kafarta musliman. And if you say about the Muslim, he is kafir, it means you are kafir. So the Prophet, he is warning us to use this word, okay? Kafir, for any deed. Because even some people, they are ignorant. They don't know about this action is kufr or not. They don't know. They don't understand. So we don't label them kafir unless there is a committee or something like lajna, or they can judge the person. We explain for the person first about his actions, and if he refused, and this af'al, what he is doing, is if it is kufr, then but we should not be busy about labeling the people, or telling the people he is kafir and this is Muslim, this is kafir. Anyone says la ilaha, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, he is Muslim, okay? Then if he did not do anything or did something will lead him to kufr, then we have to explain to him first, teach them, because maybe they are ignorant. There is al-udhr bil jahl, there is excuse because ignorance. Okay, and the authentic hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, there was a man, he did every sin, and he, when the time come for him to die, he gathered his children, sons, and he told them, asked them to burn him and to throw his dust in the air after death. And he said, the man, he said, because if Allah is able to gather me, he will punish me, a severe punishment. So this man died, the Prophet said, and Allah said, be, kun. He stood in front of Allah after death. He said, ma hamalaka ala hada, why you did that? He said, ma khafatak ya Rab, I was afraid that you will punish me. Then Allah, he said, I have forgiven you. This man have doubt that Allah will gather him back. Okay? He have doubt about the qudra of Allah. And this is why he told his children, burn me, فَإِنَّهُ إِنْ قَدَرَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ, if he is able to gather me, but he is ignorant, okay? But he have fear from Allah. Allah has forgiven him. Just to consider this, I think maybe Dr. Ibrahim, he likes, if he likes to add something for that.
And brother and sister, Allah, it's very dangerous, by the way, to make takfir for someone. In the hadith of the Prophet, Sheikh Mustafa just mentioned, من كفر مسلم فقد كفر أو باء بأحدهما. If he makes you are kafir and he's not kafir. He just mentioned the Sheikh also, if the person say أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله, he's a Muslim. I cannot accuse him, even if he becomes like Shi'i, for example, but send me shahada. Shahada. But brother and sister is very dangerous. We should not accuse anybody kafir unless he said, I believe God does not exist. Jesus is a God, or Moses is a God, or that is that. He's a kafir, but still, not my job, not your job. Leave it. It's bitter. Just listen. It's bitter. Wallahi, that the kafir going to be a lot of problems because takfir. Takfir, ignorant, into kafir, into ignorant people. Some of a lot of young guys, very famous all over the world now, they listen to them. Oh, he's an ignorant. People, I'm talking about people of knowledge, is speaking about them. If we accusing the people more and more and more, accusing the people more, we lose our deen more. My advice, if he is kafir in front of you, just turn away. You don't have to accuse the person. Because the best way here, listen and don't say anything. Hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if you see something evil, change it by your tongue, by your hand. Unable to do that, by your heart. If unable to do that, by your tongue, by your heart. I believe he is not so and so. I believe, but not publicly. This is my advice, brother and sister, that we, especially now, we have a lot of problems in the whole world. A lot of problems. Even our Trump now, he want to make another appeal that being our new president, he's not. So, brother and sister, the only way, وَإِذَا خَاطَبُوا الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. Just say salam and that's it. Better than takfir.
On the other hand, is it a, what about referring to another Muslim as being an extremist? Is it okay to do that, to say to a person that they are extreme in the religion? That's not the same as cursing a person, is it?
By the way,
yes, this, okay. Okay, we have to make balance between ignoring the people and saying the truth.
Yes.
We have to make balance. If we ignore anything, also we will not say the truth. And Allah said, الَّذِينَ يُبَلِّغُونَ رِسَالَتَهُ وَيَخْشَوْنَهُ وَلَا يَخْشَوْنَ أَحْدًا إِلَّا اللَّهِ. And if you fear Allah, and you don't fear the people. أتخشى الناس والله أحق أن تخشى. But when we talk to say the truth, we have not to say it, name the individual.
Yes.
We have to say the action. We say this action is kufr, is disbelief. We put the action itself. Like someone, if someone denies, he said the wine is halal. We tell him the wine Allah mentioned, wine is haram. Or the riba, usually is haram. I said, no, riba is halal. Eating pork is halal. It's okay to eat pork. We show, but we have to say in the end, after explaining, that the one who doesn't believe in something confirmed in the Quran and the Ijma' al-Ulama and all consensus with all scholars and approved in the Quran, يعني لو أنكر معلوم من الدين بالضرورة, then this action is kufr. But we don't label the person because he is ignorant. Okay, but we say this action is leading to disbelief. So we have to make balance to from ignoring the people or to saying the truth. Because if you ignore anything, it means we will hide the knowledge, we will not confirm the message as Allah said. Okay? And Allah said in the Quran, أَتَؤْمِنُونَ بَبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضِ. Like a president, one Al-Qaddafi one time, he said, we don't have to say قُلْ إِنْ قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ. You say, what قُلْ? Allah told the Prophet to say, but you know, just to say اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ. He wants to remove قُلْ. Okay, so we have to explain that this is kufr. We cannot remove anything from the Quran. Even the word qul, even one letter. We have to accept that he was ignorant. He was ignorant. I don't say about him he's kafir now also. But he is ignorant. But we can say, we should say this action is this disbelief. So people, they don't act like that. Wallahu a'lam. So we have to differentiate between saying the truth and accusing or like label the person, a special person with this title, kafir. But we can say, la'natullahi ala al-kafirin. May Allah curse the al-kafirin. Al-kafirin, the people, they disbelieve. You know, some people now, they think that homosexuality is halal. There is a website for the homosexuality people, the, you know, website, and the one of them, he said, I did not see anything in the Quran and the Hadith saying that homosexuality is haram. Yeah. He did not say, read anything about that, you know. Yeah. He did not read about the people of Lut, which Allah destroyed them.
Allah.
He did not read all this. Forget about the Hadith. What about the Quran? Huh? أتأتون الفاحشة ما سبقكم بها من أحد من العالمين. And he said, no, everything you have to is halal. And even there is Imam in Canada. Imam Muslim in Canada, he is a gay and he made a mosque for the gays.
Yep.
For the gays. Can you believe?
Graduated from the University of Medina.
Yeah, so this is disbelief. This is disbelief. This is disbelief. This is now kufr. We have to say the truth because this is a big sin. And he is imam, so he is learned. He knows. He is teaching people.
Yeah.
He is teaching people. Yeah. Then we have to prove. We have a proof. We have a proof in front of Allah to say this man is a kafir now, because we have a proof. Allah, the Prophet said, "Illa an takuna lakum hujjatun kufran buwahan." لكم عند الله لكم منه برهان. If you have, it's clear kufr. خلاص. And the man, he is educated. Even he is imam. And he said homosexuality is halal.
Yes.
To be gay is halal. So this is kufr. We cannot say, no, you are okay. Wallahu a'lam.
Yeah, this is sad. She also wants to know, Isra, she said, we know that we did a series on patience from the hadith. She said, "We patience is such a beautiful thing, yet it is the most difficult thing to endure." She said, "To what extent do we go with our families who cross the boundaries and who are constantly hurting you? How far do we go in patience when we're dealing with family members who are constantly hurting you? Is there an exception to when we can actually cut the family ties?"
Dr. Ibrahim, do you like to answer this question? See, a man came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was complaining about his family. He said, "Asiluhum wa yaqta'uni." I connect with them, you know, the ties with them, but they cut it. I am generous with them, but they are miser. The Prophet said, he praised him and he encouraged him to be patient. And he said, it is if you now you do good and they do bad for you, it is كأنك تصفهم الايه ال يعني المد. It is if you give them a dust, okay? So he encouraged him to be patient with them, with your family. Don't cut the ties. In wasaluk, and the Rasul said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "ليس الواصل كالمكافئ." Okay? If you deal with them, you wanted them to deal with you like you deal with them, so you did nothing, okay? No, if they cut, you know, the relation between you connect it, you connect, you be good. لا تكن إمعة تقول أنا مع الناس إذا أحسن الناس أحسن. Don't be like إمعة قالوا وما الإمعة. You say if they are good I will be good, if they are bad I will be bad. No, but if they are bad you be good as much as you can and you ignore them. That's it. والله أعلم. You can add something also.
الشيخ مصطفى, we did a very important sister asked this question actually, and in daily basis they have a problem like this. I know it's not easy, especially in our century now, this time in many families departs a problem. You know, my advice, the only way, sabr, make connection, text message. If the family close, like brother, sister, I love you, I miss you. Now, by the way, they are not replying back to you, but at least connect step by step by step. Something gonna happen. And daily basis, I'm facing this here, you know. But honestly, hard, yes. Heart is breaking your heart, yes. But our life now is different. Take it easy, at least text message, email, phone call, maybe not replying back, voicemail, leave. One day they will see that. One day they will regret they did that. The only way, have some sabr, patience, and the only way. Allah.
Okay, this is a question from Sister Layli. She says, how do we enjoin the good and forbid the evil for those Muslims who still find it hard to believe that we can buy meat from non-Muslim stores, such as the Jews and Christians? They say we supposed to buy meat from Muslim store only because they mention Allah's name before slaughter. And they base it on Surah 6, number 118, where Allah says, eat only that over which name of Allah has been pronounced. She said, so many Muslims argue and fight with you about this. She said, so what do you do? What? How would you respond to them when they say that?
Okay. I think this question, since I came to America more than 20 years, people, they ask it. And they will ask it for forever because they don't understand the Quran and they don't understand the Sunnah. Okay. She mentioned an ayah, part of the ayah. And she ignored the part. Okay? Allah said, وَلَا تَأْكُلُوا مِمَّا لَمْ يُذْكَرِ اسْمُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَإِنَّهُ لَفِسْقٌ. She did not say it. If it is fisk, and Allah in the Quran, he explained the fisk. What is fisk? Fisk, it means if you mention name other than Allah. He said, fiskan uhilla li ghayri Allahi bih. So the fisk, the definition of fisk, if you slaughter, you did not mention the name of Allah, not only this, but you mention other name other than Allah. This is fisk. This is haram. Okay, now we go to the Sunnah. Who is the one can explain the Quran better than the Prophet? No one. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ate from the meat of the people of the book. This is in the authentic hadith in al-Bukhari. A Jewish woman, she even put the poison in the ear of the lamb or whatever. Okay, and the Prophet ate. The Sahaba, they ate, even one of them died from this poison. And this is very authentic. And even this is the majority or maybe consensus of the scholars. So why? This is now exaggeration. Allah said, Ta'amu ahli al-kitabi hullu lakum. Okay? And the ta'am here, ta'am means this is the meat. Not because the fruits is halal from everyone. So the word ta'am, which is mean in Arabic food, here in this ayah is the meat. Even in the hadith, Aisha radiallahu anha, she asked the Prophet, this is authentic hadith also. She said, the people of the book, they give us meat. We don't know if they mention the name of Allah or not. The Prophet told her, Sammu antum wa kulu. You name the name of Allah and you eat. Okay? Unless you know they mention the name other than Allah, don't, you can eat. If you know that they mention name, even for the Muslim, if the Muslim mentioned the name other than Allah, it is haram. So the ulama, they said, there is no difference between slaughtering of Muslim or the people of the book. All the condition, if they fulfill the conditions of slaughtering, it becomes a haram if the Muslim or non-Muslim same, they mentioned name other than Allah. And some Muslim, they do. Sufis, whatever, they say in the name of Sheikh or name of Wali, it becomes haram. Like same of the people of the book, if they mentioned in the name of Jesus or anything. If we did not hear anything, we eat. Wallah, this is what the Prophet said. And the Prophet ate. He did not ask the woman, the Jewish woman, did you mention the name of Allah or not? He ate. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So why these people, they don't follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Sahaba, they ate, and all the scholars, they said it's okay because Allah said, if she doesn't want eat from it, but she cannot say haram because it's a big sin to say something haram which is halal. Allah said, ولا تقولوا لما تصفوا ألسنتكم الكذب هذا حلال وهذا حرام. Don't say a lie on Allah. When you say haram and it is halal, this is lie. Say kadib, this is lie. Allah said it's okay to eat and you say no. Allah allowed us for men to marry a woman from the people of the book. And we say piece of meat like this, from them it is haram. You know, but to marry whole woman is halal. So this is people, they should follow the sunnah. This is exaggeration. Okay, so to buy meat, beef, halal, from Walmart, from any American or people of the book, a Jew, it is same halal, like in a Muslim shop, store. Or the Muslim in a store, he does not slaughter by himself anyway. All this is slaughtered in slaughterhouse. Wallahu a'lam.
Okay, here's another question. Another question from Brother Ahmad. He said, there are some Muslim, and I haven't had a chance to edit this question of his. There are some Muslims, they get upset when you refer to a non-Muslim, a person that died, a non-Muslim, as kafir. He said, a few weeks ago, some famous non-Muslim died. And I told the Muslim, well, he was kafir. And the Muslim started telling me, how do I know he was kafir? Did I check his heart? And I tried to tell him, well, he was a non-Muslim. He wasn't Muslim. But he said we should never call anyone a kafir because you don't know what's in their heart. But this person was not Muslim at all. He was a kafir.
So okay, this is just a argumentation. If someone is a Christian or a Jew, he's a kafir. We say, he said kafir about the appearance, okay? And we say Muslim about his appearance. He appeared as a Muslim. And how many Muslims, they claim that they are Muslims, and Allah knows about what inside their heart. He is not talking about the heart of the person died. This man, he said kafir from what we know about his situation, okay? He was not Muslim, so he was a kafir. Okay, we did not say his heart is kafir, but from his appearance, he is kafir. And this is why we bury this person in a non-Muslim yard. If some Muslim died, we bury him in a Muslim graveyard, Muslims, from his appearance. And maybe he is kafir, but we judge the people from outside. We don't judge the people from inside. So both this is argumentation, has nothing to do with it. The man who said he is kafir, he is right, okay? Because he said from the appearance, okay? نَحْنُ لَنَا الظَّاهِرُ اللَّهُ يَتَوَلَّى السَّرَائِرُ الظَّاهِرُ, it means what appears from the person. We judge the person according to what appears from him, okay? But Allah knows what is in him. We don't judge the heart. We judge the appearance. Allahu a'lam.
Okay, Isra has a question. Isra, you can go ahead and say it on the mic.
Okay, assalamu alaikum. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Okay, so a while ago, I don't follow that person anymore, but there was a so-called sheikh on YouTube that I was listening to, a non-Muslim person, got up and asked a question about paradise. And I think this is pretty common for non-Muslims who are interested in Islam but are not sure. And so this person asked if it is true that we believe, non-Muslims are not admitted or permitted to enter paradise. And this person said, as long as they believe in God and that they're not, worshiping Jesus, then Allah will give them permission to enter paradise. And I was like, oh my God, this is not what we were taught. What is this person talking about? And so in this case, is it appropriate to call this person, a little bit extreme? I don't follow him anymore because I'm like, you're just too much for me. But I was just shocked because this was someone that was inspiring to me. I used to listen to his lectures all the time on driving to work and coming back home. But it has been at the back of my mind for a long time. And right now I look at this person different. And I know we should have our allegiance to the Muslims first. And so I don't even know what my question is. I'm just struggling here. I don't know if you guys understand where I'm going. Where I'm getting at or not.
You understand our question, Sheikh Morsy and Dr. Dremali. There's some Muslims, and I think I know who she's talking about because I hear a lot of them on Facebook, people who say that they're scholars and famous sheikhs. And now, you know, we talk about that all the time, but a lot of these famous speakers who many people like she did believe that they're scholars and listen to them, they're telling people that don't refer to kafirs as being kafirs. Well, some of them may be in paradise as long as they believed in God and went to church and didn't drink, didn't do drugs and didn't worship Jesus, they'll be in paradise too. So she's asking, how should her allegiance be to a person that believes that way? And also, I think she wants to hear what you guys have to say about that.
Okay, alhamdulillah. The faith or iman, it should be in Allah. Wa malaikatihi, his angels. Wa rusulihi, messengers. Wa al-yawm al-akhir, who believe in the day of judgment. Who believe in the decree, al-qadr. When we say you believe in all his messengers, we don't differentiate. So the people, they don't believe. They believe in Jesus. They believe in Musa, like the Jews. And they don't believe in Isa as a prophet. Okay, they reached Isa, but they denied Isa, Jesus. They are kafirs. Allah said, لا نفرق بين أحد من الرسل. We don't distinguish between messengers. Also the Christian, they don't believe. They don't believe in Prophet Muhammad. They are not Muslim anyway. If they reach Prophet Muhammad and say they deny Muhammad, it means they deny the Quran also. So they are not Muslims, okay? And they are kafirs, for sure, okay? And the Prophet said that in the authentic hadith, even Allah said, okay? Allah said, the people they worship Jesus, they are kafirs. This is in the Quran, in Surah An-Nisa and Surah Al-Ma'idah. Allah said clearly, لَقَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْمَسِيحُ بْنُ مَرْيَمُ. Allah said, they are kafirs, those they claim that Isa, he is Allah, or Ibnullah, or one of the three gods. Allah said, they are kuffar. لَقَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ ثَالِثُ ثَلَاثَ. Allah, one of the three gods. Allah said, they are kafirs. And we say, no, they are not kafirs. Yes, they are kafirs. Anyone heard the clear message, listen to the point. If they heard about Islam clearly on the right way, you know, because some people, they only receive the bad news about Islam. May Allah, this will leave them. But if they received the right message clearly about Islam and they refused, they are kafirs, okay? And it is one religion also. Allah sent one religion. Okay, because the Islam, it means submission to one God, submission. And all the prophets, they were Muslims. They were Muslims. Adam, Ibrahim, even Allah said about Ibrahim, ما كان إبراهيم يهوديا ولا نصرانيا. Ibrahim was not a Jew or a Christian, بل كان حنيفا مسلما, يعني موحدا, believes in one God, Muslim, وما كان من المشركين. So we من لم يكفر الكافر فهو كافر also. People, they claim that they are sheikhs and they say the Christian, they believe in Allah. If they believe in Allah, they should believe in the messengers. Okay? Because Allah sent the messenger. They believe in his books. وكتبه. آمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه من ربه والمؤمنون. The Rasul, the Messenger of Muhammad, believed and saw the believers. Kullun, every one of them believed in. Kullun amana billahi, they believed in Allah. Wa kutubihi, wa rusulihi, and his messenger. La nufarriqu bayna ahadin min rusuli, without differentiating between them. If they believe in one and leave one, this is kufr. If they say we believe in one of the Quran, some of the Quran, but we don't believe in some verses, this is kufr. Wallahu a'lam. So these people, they are not real sheikhs. They are nothing. Wallahu a'lam.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. I was sitting there listening because I get so passionate about that too. Just be careful, guys, who you listen to. I tell you guys that all the time. And Sister Isra, I'm so happy that Allah guided you here to Sunnah Followers and all of the new students that we have here. I'm so happy that Allah guided many of you here so that way you can learn Islam and its truthfulness. We have one more question that I have here.
This question for Dr. Ibrahim.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, but of course I took too much time. I'm sorry. أنا بعتذر يا شيخ بعتذر والله.
الله يعافيك نعم نعم. أقول يعني the question and before a lot of people hear my advice actually not the person you are kafir. If the person face to face and he appear to you he make kufr, you yes you have to make kufr and you have to believe in that. But the person far away from you, yes, listen go. You know, we don't make it because a lot of people now in social media, especially have a lot of followers and with no knowledge, I agree with that 100%, but still with those kind of people, whoever the followers, not the person, the followers, step by step. Wahda wahda in Arabic, yani take it easy, speak with the people, but don't attack that person. Bring the idea, what he thinking, and go around the idea, not what the person said. The main problem is the talk, not the person.
Yes, yes, I agree with you. I was explaining about
yes
about what this they claim they are sheikhs. They say. Yeah. So we are explaining to the Muslims. Muslim, they believe in Allah and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have to show them. What is right, what is wrong, what is Islam, what is kufr?
Yes.
So, but we don't tell the people of the book now, go, you are, no. We say, this is not Islam. When we talk to the non-Muslims, we say non-Muslims. Okay, we don't use expression, will make them unhappy or whatever. But we say, this is not Islam. But we cannot say, you are okay, this is Islam, and you will go to paradise. No, we cannot tell them that. Even Sheikh Al-Azhar, who is, Sheikh Al-Azhar Tayyib, Rabbina Ibarik Fi, he was in Germany, whatever, they told him, and he was in argument, he was a very smart person, I think, Wallahu A'lam, he's sincere also. He told the person, the non-Muslim, he said, what do you think about me? You think about me, same thing I say, think about you. You don't, the word kafir, it means you don't believe in my religion, okay? You don't believe, you are kafir. With Islam, it means you don't believe in Islam. This is the meaning of kufr. Even if the Muslim should be kafir with other religion. فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالْتَّغُوتِ Also, we are kafir with any other religion, other Islam. We don't believe in it. But we have to, like Sheikh said, we have to use the nice words when we talk to the unbelievers. Okay? So that they can listen to us. But now we explain to Muslims, we tell them the people they claim that people they worship Jesus will enter heaven. This is not right. We have to tell them that this is not right. People they worship Jesus, they will not enter heaven according to our religion, our Islam. Wallahu a'lam.
Yeah, that's why I don't do dawah. My dawah is designed for the Muslims, not for the non-Muslims, because you have to have a certain way of wording things, especially with American Muslim, non-Muslims. Here's a question. This is for Sheikh Dremali. She said, dear Sheikh, my husband makes me work. He works too, but he sends his money back home. I am tired of working, but if I don't work, we will have no way to live. What should I do? He makes me work. I guess she's providing for the family. He works too, but his money goes back home.
Why me? Why me?
She put your name for this one.
Actually, by the way, as unfortunately, there's a lot of people here in America do the same thing. Include myself, for example. I'm a professor in two universities. I make money, alhamdulillah, I have no problem with that. So I send every day part of my money, I send to my family. But guess what? Through my wife's account, I get the whole money I have, I give it to my wife, the account, and whatever she wants. But this situation here, that's the problem. She work and he is working. He's the one sending the money to his family. Number one, is not right. You can send money, but the priority is household. The household, yes, I'm going to send to my sister, my father, mine in Palestine, but my family in Palestine, in Egypt, in both actually, but Egypt. I send here and there, Egypt and Palestine. But at the same time, the main money is my that's supposed to be in my household. Household. يعني أهلك, the family, household, and put anywhere else after that. But the sister, I say something, please forgive me with that. Suppose every money, the wife, she have to hold, she can give. If she's working, you can be partnership be with that, if he agree with that, but his money actually is supposed to be in the house more than back home.
Yeah, Sheikh, her question, what she should do?
Yeah, that's what she, I got to.
Yeah, the question, Laila, what she should do?
Sister Laila said, we all have this issue. So what should they do? The money's going home.
If you have kids, by the way, discuss with them, with the husband. Because honestly, a lot of people I know in person, they got divorced because of that. Because they always, she's working and she support the house 100%. And him, my mom, my dad, my sister, my family. It's good actually, but if you really have your house number one, and have to deal that with your husband, but honestly, without divorce, take it easy with that. But I'm talking about in my family here. I'm talking about people in my family. Speak to your husband or wife, speak together. And speak to for the future for the kids. The future for you and for the kids in America here is hard. Hard. And whatever money you have, make an agreement with him. You have to agree. If not agree, go to the sheikh in the area. You know, I will make the judge. You know, I need part of the house. You can send my money, but the majority of the money is supposed to be in your own household. Household is number one in your life, not back home.
Yes, your husband, I add to you after, if you allow me, your husband, bring him to this lesson next Sunday, inshallah. Okay? Then we give him advice. Otherwise, you can take your husband to the sheikh or the imam there, which is supposed to be educated, and you discuss with the imam. So your husband needs to take advice from a scholar to behave Islamically, that number one, his family. And yes, his father, mother back home is relative. He can send part of his money. And he cannot force his wife for work. He should not.
That was the question. They want to know, can he?
Yes. He have to understand the Islam. Either to bring her husband here, okay, or to record to make him hear the answer. It is will be recorded, right? Then I'll take him to the sheikh, to the imam in the mosque.
Yeah, Allah. Sister, that whatever, if you work, this is your money. He's supposed to have support you and have. But if she's working, a little part of your money, you can live in the house. But the majority is supposed to be your husband. I know it's hard. By the way, it's hard because I don't want to have problem and divorce problem, especially the kids here. But the only way that Sheikh Mustafa just said, speak to the knowledgeable person in the area. Oh. And I think I have to finish here because I'm a guest here in this house. Forgive me, please.
Okay, that was the last question anyway. So inshallah, we can end it because that was the last one. Inshallah, guys, this is going to be recorded, uploaded to YouTube and also to our followers' website. Inshallah, any suggestions for next week, put them in email, send them to me, send them to Dr. Dremali, and we can pick a topic for then. Okay, so inshallah, everybody have a good night. Hey, Ayin. Oh, I just saw Assalamu alaikum. How are you?
Yeah, how are you? Excellent lecture today.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Shukran.
Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, guys. So inshallah, we'll see you guys later for the hadith class. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakallah khair.